Hello, I'm Ros Cuthbert from the Art Shed, Winscombe, near Bristol. In this session 5 of Use of the Brush for Watercolour, I'd like to show you how you might use a flat brush for painting buildings. I've got the photograph of some buildings in Frome, the backs of houses in Frome, up in front of me on a laptop. And the thing that I notice about this photograph is that right in the middle, there is a little metal, the end of a support or a brace for a house. And I think it's right in the middle of the composition. So why not pop in that little shape to start with? And perhaps in the middle. It's not quite in the middle, is it? Start again. Let's find out where the middle is, using my pencil as a slide rule. Somewhere there, and yeah, that's about the middle. So I'm going to just pop that little shape there. Why not? It's to orientate myself as to all these complex shapes around it, you know, the jigsaw pattern of the shapes, which I'm now going to kind of unwrap onto this piece of paper here. So just above that, I've got a sloping roof. And next to that, there's a wall. I'm going to tentatively put that in. I'm going to see if I can measure across. Yes, it's more than a third. So let's see. More than a third. So that's probably about the right place. So it goes a little bit lower than that roof, and a little bit higher. And then the base of the roof is slightly sloping down to the left, up to the right. And then the angle of the roof comes up from that, and I can't detect any converging of these lines in the photograph. It's interesting, but it's, the top of the roof is roughly there. So there's a little cable here. Dave, I'm recording, okay? So, thank you. So this roof behind, little corner there, and there's another triangle appearing of this little house that we started from here. So there is some recession of this roof a little bit away from the eye here. And so this angle of the roof would be higher, wide, longer. In fact, this would be longer. So if we can check that, yeah, that's longer. And so we know we've got a little bit of recession down and away from us there. Let's make sure I've got that whole shape long enough. I'm just going to put in the little gable window here, somewhere here. And Dave, I can hear that. Tall triangle above it. And the top of that little gable sloping down and away from us. Then there's a chimney. Tall chimney rising up. just going to quickly pop everything in that I need. Another torch in there. And the house behind. This gable disappears very quickly behind the next house, the next roof, which is slightly angled like this. I'm looking at this shape and I'm looking to see where this goes. So it comes down slightly to the left and below my brace in the wall. It's a useful point of that brace. and then I lose a little bit of it behind the shed there, so I'll leave that for now. So this roof here gives way into this one. And here we have one roof almost following on in the same line as the one next to it, so that one. They seem to be parallel. However, the roof line itself is higher. I guess we can expect that because the house is closer to us. So each time I draw something, I'm trying to relate it to those things around it, not get too far from what's happening. Keep the perspective on that chimney there. Okay, so that seems to be the edge of my picture space. So this is parallel to that side of that roof. And if I could see the whole of that, it would be there, but there's a little lean-to in the way. So it's like a quite complicated little set of shapes. Most of the time, I'm looking at it as if it was a jigsaw puzzle, rather than trying to get perspective right. I'm just looking at the shapes as they interlock. And it's not quite in the right place. I'm adjusting as I go along. And there's another quite curious little roof coming down this way, and then a wall. So, couple of windows right under the eave. And obviously there's a little window here. Another shed. Coming down to about there. Can't fall in over it. And some other interlocking shapes. So we've got lots and lots of interlocking, overlapping shapes. This wall is a bit of a bush. A bit of ivy, I think it is. And this is up to the back of someone's yard. Something like that. So here's somewhere I haven't quite got this space right. And then this window. It's better. More visible. Tiny one here. And maybe this is a chimney breast of some sort, I'm not quite sure. That could be that strange shape. There it is. Inside of that building. Then we have the roof here. So I put my way around the composition and back again, really. So I haven't put everything in. We have left all sorts of things. There's something up here on the left. Another quite a steep little roof here. More chimneys. And this is steep again, I think. Huge chimney behind this building here. And then other rooftops going back. Put some of the trees. It's visible. So that's a very rough, quick sketch of the photograph. And without making too many corrections, I'm just going to plow on with the paint. Just brush it across. And then I think I'm going to, with my same large half inch flat, which is 5/8 of an inch, I'm going to use some raw sienna and a little bit of earth red, very pale. And perhaps my blue, cerulean blue. So I'm just going to pop in some underpainting quite quickly with my flat. Just where I see a slightly more golden tint to anything, I'm going to pop it in wherever I see it as an underpainting. Next, I'll go to my pale pink and okay, wherever I see a hint of pink, I'm going to pop that in. Very pale And wherever I want a hint of grey, I'll pop in that pale blue as underpainting. So I start to orientate myself. The rooftops want a bit more of a stronger underpainting, I think. I'm going to add light red, more light red to this wash. And I might even make a little extra one with cerulean and light red, slightly more mauvey. Grey mauve wash for this house here. My wide flat enables me to work quite quickly, covering these areas and following the lines of the roof, the house. So I'm using my flat brush in different ways to fill these shapes, these triangular shapes, left some of these roof spaces, taking the flat edge of it along to define the contour, and using the broad part of it to block in. So it's a very useful brush for doing these shapes. We'll come back to the detail of that. There's a nice simple one. It's got one with the roof light somewhere. Making sure it's a similar angle to the roof so that it doesn't appear to float. Get that angle right and it will appear flat against the roof. Here we have a more varied pattern of tiles, and I'm going to sort of creep up on it a bit more. Another little Velux window, and that's a little bit more of the texture of this roof with my brush, which is something I would do, obviously, into the other ones as well. So let's put a bit more. This could have this underpainting colour. and so on. So you can see how useful the flat is for sort of filling in architectural spaces. I think the next thing would be to perhaps I'll just darken one or two places. This tarpaulin, I'd like to darken more. Actually, it's actually a wrinkle, isn't it? And maybe this roof, which is bled a little bit, we won't worry about that. Just put it back. And perhaps into window spaces. Perhaps I could do with a slightly smaller brush for some of these. Smaller flat, so I would use a little filbert. To keep the washes a little bit softer in the background. And a little bit more paint. Some of these. I'm using light red and phthalocyanine blue. Some of these tile patterns can be done with the filbert. And then it's a question of filling in the border in as we go along different surfaces. So here's a red brick wall. And a wonderful, wonderful chimney. So I'm using a filbert again to suggest. Brickwork and chimney. And across to this roof. A bit more interesting pattern on this one. So maybe we could go a bit. Suggesting these types. I think come around to just a little bit of edge into the shape. And then you can go in with as much detail and a bit of fun with that as you want. If you want to use masking fluid for some of the light window frames, you certainly could do that. Otherwise, work around them. Possibly with some Payne's Grey, a little shadowiness into the window. And so on. I think you can see how the painting can gradually be built up out of these pattern making marks. So you go and add in whatever detail you felt you wanted. Using my round now, just touching these windows. I think I've taken this far enough to give you an idea of how you can proceed. So I'll leave this demo there.